Know who's online. Let us know who is with you. Put your name in, and if you for some reason you can't get in the chat, go to the text, put it in there. Let us know who's watching, because we're caring about our congregation, whether they're here in person or that they are online. So hope that you will join us in worship today. We're going to talk today about spelunking, however you want to say it, you know, a Latin Greek word for caving a little bit. And we're going to take a look at it and compare what we need to go caving to, what you need to do to walk in the spiritual realm. So would you stand and worship with us as we prepare our hearts today?
And the way and the truth. Today we're going to be singing about him being the light, and so just sing out with us.
Into marvelous
this line I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. By the cross, you are the truth, you are the life, you are the way. And I once was fatherless, a stranger with no hope. Your kindness wakened me, out of shame.
mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. Finds me, all my fears and failures, and fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender.
Worship team, thanks for prepping our hearts. Go ahead and grab a seat, everybody. We are in this time of worship and giving, and I think most people know that you just drop it in the basket as you come in, but we are discovering that we're missing a lot of people. So what we're going to start doing next week is we're not going to pass the basket. We're just going to have somebody walk up and reach over. If you have forgot to put your giving envelope in, you can just do it that way. So just to let you know that. Different ways to give up online there if you're at home watching or if you're here with us today. So just a reminder for those, maybe you came in a little bit late watching online or whatever, make sure you sign in the chat at the bottom. That helps us, or text us in there. So a little promo for everybody here is we have a series coming up. If you could pop that graphic up there for me. promo graphic. What do you do with what you have? It's a two-week series, and we're going to be taking a look at the free gifts that we have been given to us. If you think about it, there's things that you have that you did nothing to get. And then the following week, we got a kind of a special guest coming, if you could pop that up there for me, Pastor Daniel Surratt from out at Lifehouse. He's going to be coming to preach. I'm hoping that you will come out, you will support him, and you will tell him this is a better church than his, something like that. Yeah, so. All right, good to have you folks with us today. So as we get ready to head into this time, we're going to have a time of prayer after. Some of you know this. You know, Gary passed away, and here's Sandy up here playing bass, and what a blessing she is. And that's because she knows about the kingdom, and she knows about every one of you. She loves you, cares about you, and serving. So we'll have a word of prayer with her after this song. So worship with us.
Father's glory, lay his spirit there.
Amen, yes. Maybe you might just lift your hands in the air today as we're going to pray for Sandy today. Today, 7 to 4 o'clock, calling hours here at the church for Gary. Sandy, we love you so much. Appreciate your effort and just even being here. She's playing at the funeral, bass, because Gary's favorite bass player was Sandy. 11 o'clock on Monday, come on out, support. Father God, today we just understand the family, and we're Sandy's family. We're a part of her family. She's a part of ours. And so as we prepare to just share the gospel today, I know that that is one of the reasons that Sandy is here and she's worshiping and wants to be a part of it. May your spirit comfort her like nobody can. You said, come unto me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. May you give that to her. And now may you turn our attention today to the word of God and to every one of us here today. May we hear it specifically and know what it is you want us to do. In Jesus' name I pray. Could you say amen? Amen. Amen. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Sandy. Spelunking. Spelunking. However you say it, right? Caving. My wife, Maria, she has, ever since we were married, talked about going to caves. She's talked about wanting to go to caves. I think she, if I remember correctly, I forgot to ask her this, she's working today. I think I remember that when she was real young, they went to a cave somewhere. I don't know, maybe it was a cave in the neighborhood, I don't know. But she loves to hike, and she has told me for 37 years, something like that, she really wants to go caving. You know, she wants to go someplace and hike underground where it's dark, cold, and miserable. And so for years, I was a good husband and said, yeah, we'd like to do that sometime. All the while you're saying, yeah, we'd like to do that sometime. You know, what the? I have no desire to walk in a dark cave in some smelly armpit of a place. I don't know. And so as we moved on year after year, finally we prepared a vacation. With Daniela's help and planning and Elizabeth and that, we planned to go to Mammoth Cave. Mammoth Cave, Kentucky. We got an Airbnb home on Lake Nolan, right? We were all set, ready to go. You know, it was just like, and I'm like, okay, I am married. I have to die to self, do what my wife wants to do and my kids want to do. And then Jesus answered my prayer. Last year, doggone COVID. God sent a pandemic answer to the world answering my prayer. Not wanting to have to go walking down that. I'm sure I'm going to end up there someday, but I digress. Spelunking, you know, it's from the word, it's from the Latin and the Greek. It sounds a lot like cave. In your notes I have, it's also, you know, it's caving, right? A recreational pastime for those who need a frontal lobotomy. For those, and some, many of you are thinking, I just don't like walking. I mean, if I had a dirt bike, you know, if I had a four-wheeler, you know, a snowmobile, something that you just do this or something and it moves, well, I'm just that way. But I walk with her because I love her, and I have here in your notes, at the top of your notes, go to your Bible app or just go to your hard notes there, exploring. And I have the word exploring there because people love exploring. I mean, I'm not sure I would have liked to have done what Lewis and Clark did in 1803 for 3 years, discovering after the Louisiana Purchase the western part of the United States. 3 years of documenting it, but people love exploring. People love mountains. People love trails, love caves. I have a little bit of a balance issue, you know, that, you know, I know everybody says I'm off balance. I get that. So my family, they get close to the edge of some of these things, and I just turn, cry, and run the other way. And people love adventures, and there are three main pieces of equipment that I want to talk to you about today that have to do with, if you're going to go in a dark, smelly cave, it's probably not smelly, but in my mind it is, you know, there's three pieces of equipment you want to make sure that you have. You know, without them, you could get lost, you could get hurt, and literally you could die, which has happened if you know anything about it. So if you're going to enter into a spiritual life, I want to take those three pieces of equipment and help you see exactly what the scriptures teach in regards to these different kinds of pieces of equipment, right? If you're exploring the spiritual world and a spiritual life, you would want to use the same principles that we use if you're going into a cave. And so we have to have this understanding of what it takes, and the Bible is always trying to educate us. It's always trying to give us God's wisdom. So with God's understanding today, let's take a look at Romans, the 13th chapter, and verse 11, the second half of it says, understanding the present time, semicolon, right? Understanding the present time. How many people do you think that you know that think we live in the present day in a dark world? How many people would say that? How many people would say or know that or even think that? And what does that mean? Read on. The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than it when we first believed. The truth of the matter is the longer you live, the closer you are to going to see Jesus. And he says in verse 12, the night is nearly over. Well, if he's talking about going from this life to the next life, in this world, you know, it's dark. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. That's why the worship team, Candy, was singing songs that had to do with light, Jesus being the light. Put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime. You ever notice how sometimes when it gets dark, there's a lot of things people do? They, you know, crimes. You take a look at the number of crimes that happen day versus night. You know, different things that happen. It just is a picture of what goes on. As in the daytime, right? Decently, not in carousing and drunkenness, nor in sexual immorality, debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh. Now, would you do me a favor? Would you take next to the word flesh there and write sinful nature? Because he's not talking about this kind of flesh. He's talking about the flesh as the sinful nature. It's a better translation. So you probably already know this. You see it up on stage. You know, if you're going to go caving, spelunking, you don't want to go, number one, without a headlamp, right? Caves are totally pitch black. You know, the kind that you cannot see your hand in front of your face. And if you can't see your hand in front of your face, imagine the darkness that the world is in. You know, so a headlamp and a helmet oftentimes come together. I'm sure you can go with a flashlight, but if you have something like this, your hands are free, you know, to, you know, catch yourself if you fall, hold somebody's hand, whatever it is. So you put a headlamp on that has a light. Now, there are two kinds of light in the spiritual world I want to talk to you about today. The first one, let's see if you can figure it out, is in John 8:12. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Jesus didn't say, call yourself a Christian, go to church, this, that, the other. He said, follow me. I'm the light of the world. You want to walk in the light, the spiritual light? The first light is Jesus Christ himself. In order to have the light of the world, you have to follow him. You can't just say, I know about him. You have to pick up your Bible. That's why the number one thing we talk about here is the scriptures. You have to be in the scriptures. You have permission to challenge what the preacher or anybody from up here says. You need to open the scriptures. You need to take a look at what the scripture says. See, we know exactly what that means to follow somebody, right? To follow a sports figure or to follow a personality or to follow somebody on Facebook. The truth of the matter is Jesus Christ has sent you a friend request. He gave his life for you. He sent you a friend request. Maybe you haven't clicked on it, or maybe you defriended him or unfriended him. How you doing with Jesus today? Number one focus. Out of everything in the world. You may not like what's happening in the world. I may like what's happening, but there's a spiritual world out there that is light. People need to walk in it and out of the darkness. The second light I want to talk to you about is found in Psalm 119:05. Your word is a lamp for my feet, a light on my path. God has made sure that we have his word. People have tried to destroy it, tear it down, discredit it, and to no avail. We talk here several times a year about how you know you can trust the scriptures, but that's not what this message is about. Do you know Jesus Christ, the light of the world, and the word of God are literally one and the same? If you do a word study on John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So there's two sources of light, but really and truly, they are one source of light, the Word. No smart caver would ever enter a cave without the light and without a map. And so when you think about a map, here's a map up here of Mammoth Cave. I don't really know how much you can see it there, but all kinds of trails, all kinds of... Somebody went before into the cave and mapped it out. The Word of God says Jesus Christ came from heaven. He was in heaven. He is on earth. He understands the spiritual world. He mapped out the way. And when you read the Scripture, and when you follow the Scripture, when you follow the Lord Jesus Christ, you literally are walking with Him in this spiritual world, in the dark world. No serious Christian would walk the trails of life without the Word of God. Without the Word of God, without God's trail map. It helps Evan learn how to deal with sin, how to deal with forgiveness, persecution when I stand up for Christ and things don't go my way, how to train my mind, how to give me wisdom. How do I know what I don't know about the spiritual world? How do I know? Because one was there. His name was Jesus. You'll see, if you mark this down, the Gospel of John, the third chapter, you will see Jesus telling Nicodemus, you don't know what's in the next world unless you've been there. You don't know what's in the spiritual light unless you've been there. Jesus is the light of the world because He came from heaven. So put your spiritual headlamp on. Otherwise, whether you know it or not, you're wandering around in dark. You are wandering around in darkness unless you know Jesus Christ, and at least unless you open the Scriptures and don't call... I know it matters what you call yourself, but are you a follower of Jesus Christ? You open the Scriptures, you see what He teaches, you do what He teaches. You don't say, I like this, I don't like that. You notice Jesus doesn't say, if you love me, you'll listen to my suggestions. If you love me, you will keep my commands. That's how you know if you love Jesus. Number two, you know, if you're going to go caving, spelunking, right, you need boots. Right? Inside a cave, the terrain can be rough, it can be wet and slippery, there's tight places. I actually read a couple different things where people got caught in very tight places. So you need a good pair of waterproof, good traction boots. So your boots take your feet where you're always going to go. Now in this passage that we just read in verse 13, it says, let us behave decently. My behavior is where I walk. It's where my feet take me. You know, it's where I go, it's where I walk, it's what I do, right? You need a good pair of boots. A passage of Scripture says, let us behave decently as in the daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, sexual immorality, debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. So he's basically saying, hey, Evan, you know, before you came to know Christ, you developed some habits that some were just habits and others were sinful. Maybe what you ate was a habit and what you got used to was a habit, or maybe you worked out or whatever you did. It was a habit, but there are habits that are sinful. There are habits that people, until you come to know Christ, until you open the Scriptures, we don't realize that, man, we're living in a sinful world. You know, I was talking to a guy this past week, Kip, if you're listening, this is about you. He said he was going to take several weeks. They have a camper. They're going to travel across the country. One of the things he said he showed up at his house two boxes of Merrell hiking boots. I had no idea what they were. I had to look them up. I guess they're pretty good boots. Two pairs, one for his wife and one for him. You got to have a good pair of hiking boots if you're going to head into a cave, because where my feet go, verse 13 says that's my behavior. That's my behavior. Every step that you take in a cave is a step that you have to make a decision about. You know, you got to look around. You got to look down. You know, you're going in between things. You can get caught between two rocks. You can slip. You can get stuck and or hurt, right? The Bible teaches us to keep in step with Jesus. Keep in step with Jesus, His way, right? We can't give our life to Jesus and then live our life our way. That's not giving your life to Jesus. That's maybe making some type of an emotional decision, and I like Jesus, but if you're a follower of Christ, you live your life His way. It's His kingdom. It's what He wants. I mean, how many overconfident cavers ignored trail maps? I actually read a little article about a guy, I'll leave his name out of it, an avid hiker. Avid hiker, right? They found that he was missing for the longest period of time. The family couldn't find him. They sent a thing out to any cavers that were out there, you know, and this was actually in Mammoth Cave. Now, don't forget, Mammoth Cave is inside caves, and then there's a national park. I think I have a note here, 53,000 acres, 80 square miles, right? He went missing. He was avid. He knew what he was doing. Do we know what we're doing? Have we assumed certain things? Oh, I'm a Christian, but I can do this. I'm a Christian, I don't have to go to church. I'm a Christian, I can do this. Yeah. Have we assumed certain thing that the scriptures readily denied? The thing that always amazes me is people who think they can be a follower of Jesus but won't be in his establishment, the church, the one that he died for, the one he rose from the dead to put into place, the one that he said he's the head of it. All throughout the New Testament, talking about the church, and everybody says, I don't need to be a Christian to go to church. I mean, I don't need to go to church to be a Christian. It boggles my mind. How could they be reading the scriptures in any way, shape, or form, right? When we put our spiritual boots on, our behavior must follow the right path, and the path is formed out there for Jesus, by Jesus. And then the number three is, you know, you don't want to go spelunking without the proper clothing, right? Caves are damp, they're cold, they're dark. You know, if you go spelunking, you need the right clothing. You need something that's warm but dry but lightweight, right? This is what I read and this is what I do. I haven't done it personally, but this is what people tell me. I haven't done it personally yet. Unless my wife gets her way, which she will, and you guys all know that, right? So before we come followers of Jesus Christ, there was things in my life that had to change, and there's things in your life that has to change. As you read any story of anybody in the scripture who comes to God in the Old Testament or comes to Christ in the New Testament, there are things that begin to change. There are things that have to drop off, right? The passage here says to put on Jesus Christ, right? Rather clothe yourself. All this is a picture. You know, you take off Evan's old life and now you put on the designer line of Jesus Christ. You know, he's got his own designer line, right? Clothe yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't think about how to gratify the desires, and let me just put in the sinful nature. Don't think about how to give into the sinful nature. You see, when I got saved, I was working in a welding shop, 25, 26 years old. Working in a welding shop, you know, I actually talked to a couple of people about this week, you know, you got to watch your mouth eventually. My mouth was every swear word you can imagine. We didn't know how to communicate. I always tried to tell my children and other people, you know, if you have to use a swear word, it's just a matter that you have a low IQ. Because there's a much better, creative, clean word that could describe it. But I'm sure that doesn't apply to anybody here, so, right? I had to work on my language. If you're here and you've been a Christian any length of time and you're using foul language, get it cleaned up. Scripture clearly talks about that. The other thing, you know, with guys in a welding shop, they had pictures of naked ladies on all the walls in different places like that. Now you come to follow Jesus Christ, and instinctively, you know, man, I can't be looking at that, can't, you know, boom, boom, boom. And I'll tell you, when it went through, me and my friend Pete Zafferatis, you know, gave our lives to Christ, it was amazing the difficulty that we had in that welding shop. The persecution that happened, the yelling, the argument. It's almost like, you know, you start trying to walk good and do what's right, and everybody, you know. And I'll tell you, it was really nice to have somebody with me. We could talk about it. We could be there for one another. You know, if you're in a place where you are by yourself, that's a tough thing. But you still need to know, and you need to stand with Jesus Christ. You see, I clothed myself with things that just the rest, every other guy would. How about you? Are there some things that you need to take off in order to clothe yourself with Jesus Christ? Are you ready to clothe yourself with Christ, to put on his clothing line? I actually have a graphic up here. Jesus is essential. Everybody says they're essential, but Jesus is the essential one. If you care about eternity, if you care about your spiritual life, his clothing line is he's essential. He is going to tell you how to walk righteous. The Bible tells us we should, the word righteous, don't be afraid of it. It just means to live right. according to God, not live right according to Evan. Live right according to God. His clothing line, he is essential. He's the one that says his ways matter, his ways are important, his behaviors are what I need to practice, and his kingdom comes first. That's one of the reasons Sandy Brown is here today. You have a great excuse not to be here, except seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. All these other things will be added to you. That's the people that honestly bless pastors many times, people that know and get that, right? If we are ready to clothe ourselves with Jesus Christ, he's ready to forgive us of our sins. He's ready to forgive us of our sins and give us the gift of eternal life. Give us the gift of eternal life. In your notes, I put the phrase, many people have gone spelunking, caving. They've enjoyed beautiful hiking experiences, right? They knew that they needed a headlamp. They knew they needed a flashlight. They knew they needed the boots, the clothing. They knew they needed that. And in just doing a little bit of research, 2 million people, it's an estimated number of people, visit caves every year. 2 million people, right? An average of roughly 50 people a year fall victim to an accident, death, or whatever. Guess what? Out of those 50 people, 83% of them are men. Because we don't need directions. We're not going to stop and use a map. I know where I'm going, honey. That's happened to you? Yeah. I mean, guys are those overconfident guys that just think, I don't need it. And you know, I find the same thing when it comes to Jesus. How many men in their pride will not let them come to an altar to give their life to the one who hung on the cross, humiliated, probably naked, giving his life for you? Find the same thing with men, really do. Many people have fallen victim to that. I want you to, sure, go caving, enjoy it smartly and safely, but why don't you do the same thing with your spiritual life? Why don't you and I, why don't we do the same thing? Don't go into eternity without your sins nailed to the cross of Jesus Christ. That happens by somebody saying, I know I'm a sinner. I know I need the light of the world. I know that I need Jesus Christ. That's how it happens. It happens oftentimes. Let me ask you guys a question here. Everybody, I'm going to ask in just a second here, how many people here came to an altar to either give their life to Christ or for some other thing? In just a second, I'm going to ask you to stand, because I'm going to ask, if you don't know Christ, to come meet him at the altar today and simply say, I know I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sins. I know you went to the cross for that. Come into my life, and today I'm going to use the three tools, Jesus the light and his word. I'm going to make sure I got my boots on. I'm going to change clothing. I'm going to put Jesus Christ on. So for those of you here today who have ever been to an altar that gave your life to Christ, would you please stand today? Awesome. Thank you so very much. Look around. Many, many person has been to the altar. Go ahead and grab a seat. So that if you decide to come, because you probably having a battle going on right now, your heart's thumping for sure. I get it. I know it. Would you listen to the words in Jesus from Jesus in John the 3rd chapter? He's the one who knows heaven. He is the one who knows earth. He just knows the spiritual realm. This is the verdict, right? You know what the word verdict means, right? When the trial's over, here's the verdict. Pound the gavel. Boom. Here's the verdict, everybody. Jesus said, here's the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. That's where I used to live. Is that where you live? You don't have to continue to live there, right? Darkness is in the world spiritually. Verse 20, everyone who does evil hates the light. Man, people who do what is wrong, people who do what is evil, they don't even want to hear it. They're having too much fun, and don't let anybody deceive you. Sin is fun. But there is an expiration date on that fun. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. Is somebody saying, this is wrong? But whoever lives by the truth, and I hope this is you today, comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. They're not afraid of coming into the light. They're not afraid of saying, you know what? From now on, my behavior will be in the sight of God. He'll help me. He'll clean me up like he cleaned up my mouth and my eyes. He'll clean us up. It's a process, I know, and I get it. Worship team is going to come, and we're going to close with this song, Come As You Are. It's basically, sometimes people say, you know what? Once I get my life cleaned up, then I'll come to the Lord Jesus Christ. No. The passage of Scripture says, here's the verdict. There's light and there's darkness. And so here, come on up, you guys. Here's the asterisk. Do you love darkness more than light? That is the question after the words of Jesus. Do I love darkness, my sin, my way, more than light? And you all have a free will to just live there and go on into eternity without Christ. But today is the opportunity for you to do what you saw many people here do and what I did several times. Come to an altar because it's the place where God comes and where God meets us. Darkness is my way. It's my deeds. No one's going to tell me what to do. Light is Jesus Christ and the Bible. It lights my path. It tells me how to walk. It tells me what to do, right? God's way is what I'm going to do from now on. God's way, what I'm going to do from now on. So will you come into the light is the question today. Could you dim the lights for me, and could you, the worship team just begin just a little bit? Will you come into the light, and will you come to the altar? You know, the words in the song, at any time, say, just come to the altar. Come to the altar. Come by yourself. Bring somebody with you, but it's got to be of your own free will. Many a Christian, their journey began at this altar. Their spiritual life began in this altar. The people that you see, they were not afraid to come kneel at an altar to say to Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know you died for my sins. They were not ashamed of the one who was humiliated on a cross, took a beating publicly that you now don't have to take. He took it for you. I talked to Sandy and the family the other day, and I asked Sandy if I could tell you this. There was a series of events that happened where Gary was at church because of his son, Billy Nicholson's funeral, police officer, and a message on marriage. And Sandy said she remembers very distinctly her husband elbowing her, pushing her, get out of the way, because he was coming to the altar. I hope that that'll be you today. Why don't you stand and let's worship? And as you feel the freedom of the Lord, you can just come, spend a couple minutes at the altar talking to the Lord Jesus today. Give your life to Jesus. Let's stand and worship.
Sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let the rescue begin. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come kneel. Earth has a sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has a sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face.
Wander, come home today. Come home today.
There's hope for the hopeless and all those who stray. Come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, a rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. Thank you. There's joy for the morning, a sinner be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal.
Father, that's good news. Come as you are, just the way that we are. You're the one that does the cleanup work. You're the one that takes our sins and forgives us. For those who are at the altar today, may you do a work in their hearts and their lives to seal the work. May they begin by opening the scriptures. A good place to begin to read is the Gospel of John. May they open the scriptures, begin to read. We have a Bible for those of you here today that want a Bible with a compass, because it gives you direction, with a bookmark, a good place for you to begin to read. So you come and get that, and you see me before you leave here today. Jesus, may we be found faithful in this church to be around to help and disciple and to let other people know who have come to know you, that you, Lord Jesus, are their Lord and Savior. I pray in Jesus' name. And all God's people, amen. Thank you for the work today, Lord. Would you grab a seat? Would you have just a couple quick announcements?
All right. All right, so our first announcement for today is that we have this week the American Red Cross coming to Lifeline. It'll be from 1 to 7 p.m., and it'll be in the Hebrews Cafe. To schedule an appointment, go online to redcross.org, and there'll be instructions in the program for you to follow if you'd like to sign up. Also, Jim and Lori Barrett would like to invite you to the entire church to their home, that's in Painesville, for the last night of their creation Bible study. So if you haven't been to the whole Bible study, you can still attend this event. They're going to be showing the movie outdoors called Dismantled. It's a film about the deconstruction of the evolution theory. So you can sign up for that in the Welcome Center. I'm told that they have a really cool backyard, and it would be probably a really good thing if you have middle school or high school kids to get them involved as well in that. There is a flyer in the program. We have a really awesome event coming up for the kids this summer. It's kind of going to tail on the back end of Awana's after that end. So it's the Lifeline's Summer Kids Club. And this theme this year is Treasured, discovering your priceless to God. The your mattered in that sentence. So that program will run from June 9th to August 11th on Wednesdays, 6:30 to 8 p.m., This week, our focus is on getting volunteers, so you'll find that flyer in your pamphlet today. The kids need you. It is very important that you come and you sign up. Bonnie's even said that she'll work through your summer vacation schedules if you can't be there certain times, but please come, help, lend a hand, so we can train up these kids in the way that they should go. And then next week, we'll be focused on taking registrations for the program. Next month, we'll be celebrating our graduates. If you're graduating or have a graduate in your family, that's high school, college, or trade school, please fill out this Aqua Communications card. They're in the seats in front of you by the prayer cards and tithing envelopes. Write other on that. There's like little boxes you can check, and then just fill out the name of the graduate, the school they're graduating from, and place it in the giving basket back there so we can get them all squared away. All of the notes for today, the events and upcoming, I think this is the most you've had on a front of a flyer in a long time. So there's a lot of good stuff coming up. Take this home, put this all in your calendar, and then there's more information in the inside explaining each thing. If you're a guest with us today, you can go to the Welcome Center as well. Grab yourself a nice little mug here that we have for you, or see somebody that's got a name tag on. Any of us will help you. Please pick up your kids. and say thank you to the teachers, and then stick around for some fellowship and enjoy the rest of your day.
If you gave your life to Christ, I'd like to get you a Bible, so come on up and see me. Have a great day, everybody. You're dismissed.